This is Whitley Strieber, and this is Dreamland. You've reached the edge of the world. First up today, Eric von Daniken, who is going to be at Contact in the Desert, where I will be too at the end of this month, May 31st through June the 3rd. Then an incredible guest returns, Riz Virk, to talk to us about The Matrix. He thinks it's real, and with his credentials, you'll be amazed at what a good argument he makes that this isn't even real reality. Who are we? What are UFOs? And how can it be that the idea of The Matrix could explain their flight characteristics? It's a great show. Stay tuned. TheNewUnknownCountry.com should be deployed during the week that this show is running. When you see the new graphics, you will be able to subscribe to UnknownCountry.com using your credit card or PayPal. Do not try to subscribe if you see the old graphics. It will not work. Your information will not be saved and the subscription won't work. The new graphics are very dramatic. You can't miss them. Okay, so we certainly hope that you decide to subscribe after seeing the new graphics, and we hope you like the website in its new form. Well, today, a fascinating guest has returned with an even more incredible book. Riz Virk is back with us after about a year. He entertained us tremendously with the idea of the treasure hunt last March, and now has come back with a real game changer. This is terribly extraordinary and serious. It's called The Simulation Hypothesis. An MIT computer scientist, and you'll find out as you learn more about Riz, that is just the surface, shows why AI, quantum physics, and Eastern mystics agree we are in a video game. Riz is a graduate of MIT and Stanford. He's an entrepreneur, a video game pioneer, a film producer. He's a venture capitalist, a best-selling author. He's not only Treasure Hunt, but also Zen Entrepreneurship. His video games include Tapfish and Penny Dreadful Demi-Mundane. He currently runs Playlabs at MIT. Riz, welcome back to Dreamland.
Well, it's great to be back on the show with you, Whitley.
Yeah, it is great to have you back. And you have your book is involved with the work of an author who is also very close to me in a strange way. Phil Dick and I shared the same agent.
We
never,
oh, really?
Yeah, we never intersected, but we were both agents of clients of Russell Galen. And so Dick had passed on by the time I came along. But I had the experience of knowing Dick a little bit through Russell, which was, of course, he's an agent, so he's very discreet. But nevertheless, it was really, really interesting.
Yeah, you know, as part of the research for this book, I interviewed Philip K. Dick's last wife, Tessa B. Dick, and, you know, she told me a lot about his beliefs. And, of course, I reference a lot of his science fiction, you know, throughout the book. So the book is kind of a melding of science, speculation, science fiction, and Eastern mysticism and Western religions as well. But, you know, she said that he actually believed that we were living in a computer programmed reality, and that sometimes whoever was running it would change the timeline on us. And she said that according to him, he actually remembered an alternate timeline where the Nazis and the Japanese won World War II, and that was the basis for his book, The Man in the High Castle, which is a very popular Amazon series now.
Which it sure is. It's fabulous.
Yeah, and I didn't realize that, you know, his beliefs went that far into it. I mean, I knew his work was very much about artificial intelligence and questioning reality, but the more I looked into it, the more I spoke with Tessa and his speeches, I realized that, you know, he was a big believer and a pioneer in this concept as well. Well,
that speech he gave in France, he came out and absolutely said it.
Yeah, in fact, he said, you know, we are living in a computer program reality and the parameters can be changed, and the only clue we have that the parameters may have changed is when something is different or we have these feelings of deja vu. And it's funny because that ties back to the conversation we had last time in Treasure Hunt about deja vu and intuition and synchronicity being glitches in the matrix.
Right. Right.
And in fact, you know, he wrote the story, The Adjustment Team, again, according to Tessa, based on an experience he had where, you know, he felt like somebody had come in and changed his physical house. Like there used to be a light switch and now there was a chain to turn the light on and off. And he clearly remembered, you know, this opposite. It was a small little change, but it inspired that short story where, you know, this guy is about to go to work and he arrives and they've frozen the entire building and all his coworkers are frozen. They're de-energized, he calls it, and
yeah, they're adjusting their memories.
and you know, eventually that became the basis for that the hit movie The Adjustment Bureau with Matt Damon.
Right.
But, you know, that was a very interesting idea and set of beliefs that he had. You know, in fact, when I asked Tessa, would Phil have liked The Matrix? She said, oh, he would have loved it. That would have been his first reaction. And second reaction was, can I sue these guys for stealing my idea?
Yeah. Well, you know, Phil he had a hard life and died poor, and now, of course, his estate must be very wealthy. Getting back to this, though, the whole business of time slips and sliding around in time, we've had a guest on Dreamland a number of times called Starfire Tor, and she talks about time slips. She talks about them a lot and, in fact, knows a lot about them. And Anne and I were once out with her and her boyfriend at the time, and in a place that it had a very tiny bathroom for women. And it was a fairly complicated area, so I was hanging nearby because I wanted to be sure that when Anne came out, she didn't go in the wrong direction. We spend the rest of the evening trying to find each other in this crazy place. It's called the Magic Castle. So I was waiting right there and the door opened and a woman came out sort of as Anne came out. It was very strange. Two people came out and one of them walked up to me. It was Anne and the other one walked off. And then Starfire came out and I said, who was that other woman? And Starfire said, what other woman? And I said, well, Annie, did you see her? She said, yes. I couldn't figure that out. Where did she come from? And so we looked through the restaurant, and we soon found her. And she said, yes, I was walking out of the bathroom, and all of a sudden there was a woman beside me who hadn't even been in the bathroom. And then she looked at Anne and said, it was you. And I think that's a time slip of some kind.
Yeah, it's almost like there's, you know, these multiple realities going on at the same time and they're starting to merge together. So I think, you know, between time slips and this idea of the Mandela effect, right, where people remember different versions of when Nelson Mandela died, that, you know, in the book, you know, one of the sections I explore how a lot of these unexplained phenomena, which don't have great explanations from a scientific point of view, you know, could actually be happening. And it turns out that the simulation hypothesis, you know, with this idea that we're in a type of simulation in a video game. Now, you know, some people get upset when I say we're in a video game. They're like, I'm not living in Mario Brothers. What are you talking about?
Right, yeah, you're just living in one with have different clothes.
Right. Exactly. But, you know, the simulation we're talking about here is obviously, you know, way more complex than the video games of today that we can create thus far. Just like today's World of Warcraft and today's Fortnite games are way more complex in order of magnitude than Pac-Man or Space Invaders from when I was a kid and the games that I used to play, you know, back in the day.
Right.
But I do think with you know, that's interesting about the time slip. There was an experiment recently, an MIT Technology Review did an article about this, and you know, this came out after I had written the book. But they had quantum physicists were confirming that you could have a series of like six entangled particles, and it was based on an old physicist named Wigner. His idea that if Wigner and Wigner's friend were both looking at these from different places, would they see different things? And they were able to confirm a situation where they both saw different entanglement on these particles, which meant that basically there was no objective reality that each person was seeing something that was slightly different.
Slightly different. Yeah, I'm familiar with that extraordinary story, but go ahead.
Yeah, and so, but what it means is, to a certain extent, just like in a video game, if you and I are playing Second Life, which is a virtual world, or World of Warcraft, and both of our characters are there, there's no shared rendered world. There's only information on the server. On my laptop, like say, which I'm looking at right now, I could see my avatar, which might be like an orc or an elf, and I could see your avatar, and we're both in the same room, but each of our computers is rendering it. So there's right. this idea of subjective rendering, and I think that's closer to what may really be happening as we talk about, as I talk about the great simulation, which is what I call, you know, the world around us that is indistinguishable from physical reality.
We're going to take a brief break for our free Dreamlanders. We'll be right back.
Whitley Strieber became the host of Dreamland in 1998, and he's still the host today. One of the first podcasts, Dreamland has been built into the premier program of its kind, exploring the edge of science and reality. The show's archive on unknowncountry.com dates back to 2004 and contains nearly 700 episodes. Dreamland is a treasure unique in the world. Ever wonder what the close encounter experience is all about? Think you know what it's about? When you open Whitley and Ann Strieber's Immortal Communion Letters, you're going to experience a whole new vision, not something being told to us by researchers and theorists, but the actual testimony of people who came face to face with this unknown. Unforgettable. And the book is only $3.99 at Strieber.com.
We're talking to Riz Firk. His new book, The Simulation Hypothesis, his website, zenentrepreneur.com, that's zenentrepreneur.com. Go to the blog section. It's full of fascinating links. I think you'll find them, the stories that he's chosen, to, very fascinating and provocative. We're going to be talking about some of that in a little while. Now, this idea of simulation, to me, it really starts with Phil Dick, but does it go back farther than that?
Yeah, you know, it's a really old idea in many ways, and in the book I try to bring that out, right? I mean, I don't claim to be the first person to think of this. It's been around for a while. I mean, I think, you know, recently, because of the popularity of The Matrix, which literally came out 20 years ago this month, so you know we're on the 20th anniversary, which is when I chose to release the book, is when I think a lot more people started to think about it. But really, you can go as far back as Plato, so you're going back 2,000-3,000 years now, and his analogy of the cave, which you know many of the listeners may have heard of, but some may not have, which is this idea that we all live inside a cave, Plato thought, and we're chained to a wall on one side of the cave. There's an opening on the other side, and all we can see from what's going on in the world outside the cave are shadows against the wall. So if we're living our whole lives in this cave, we're making up descriptions of reality based upon these shadows that we see on the wall. But we don't really know what's going on outside the cave, and you know, there's some light out there that's casting these shadows, which would be the sun. But again, if you were chained to in a cave your whole life, you wouldn't even know what that is. And he also surmised that if anyone were to break free of his chains and go out there, well, initially they might be blinded by the light, but when they came back in and they were trying to tell everyone else who's still chained to the walls what it's like out there, that no one would believe him, which, you know, often ties to the beginnings of a lot of mystical experiences. So yeah, the idea goes way back. I mean, if you think of the whole idea of Buddhism, right? The Buddha means literally to be awake. Right. And there's a section in the book where I talk about Tibetan dream yoga, where you learn to recognize that inside a dream, you realize that the dream is an illusion and it's not the real world. What we would call lucid dreaming today, but this is a tradition that goes back, you know, many, many hundreds of years. And then they use that awareness to try to realize that the physical world around us is like a dream as well. I mean, you can go back to Descartes, who philosophized that there could be an evil demon trying to trick him that there was a world out there and sending information to his senses. But he said that if he saw it in a dream or in some kind of simulation, as long as he discovered something or understood something, it doesn't mean he didn't really understand it, but that the whole world, you know, could be a type of deception, you know, which ties much to
you know, you have a, we have a mutual friend in Dr. Jacques Vallée, who is quoted in your book and who speaks about, I think he even gave you a blurb, you lucky guy.
Yeah, he gave me a great blurb.
He says, the simulation hypothesis presents a radical alternative to current models of reality. Recent speculation in physics shows us that the world we perceive may be an emerging entity produced by an underlying pattern inaccessible to our senses. Now, here's the fascinating thing about this, that there is something going on. You know, I know that you are aware of the new book that's just come out by, I'm going to forget his name, darn it, Bernardo Kastrup, The Idea of the World, which argues that this is an idea, that this isn't reality in any final sense. But I want to get back to that word you used, deception, which is a huge part of Jacques' thinking, and that there is a deception going on. When right after she died, my wife returned in very provable ways. She was really careful about it. And one of the first things that she said to me is, it's a game. Is this a dangerous game? What is going on here, Riz?
Wow. So she actually said to you that it was a game.
Yeah, that was one of the first things she said.
Yeah, that's incredible. I mean, I do think that the game analogy is something that we can understand now because of the technology we've developed and the way that we play video games, and situations are created for us inside video games with quests and achievements. You know, that's how modern games work. And, you know, in the book, I describe this idea that we all might have quests and achievements in the game. Now, what is the purpose of the game and who's running the game? Right. Now, those are speculative areas, right? And I'm happy to speculate on that along with it, with anyone else. But I think anyone who's had experience, you know, with somebody who's passed on and believe it was a real visitation will buy into the idea that the physical world isn't all that there is, but, and that we can get information and visits, you know, from people beyond. It's very much like, you know, being able to go into a multiplayer game and send messages into that world. And there may be rules and restrictions around what they're allowed to tell us or not allowed to tell us. But just like with Plato's Cave, you get a lot of people who, you know, aren't willing to believe it because they've been, you know, chained to the wall. What is the purpose of the game? You know, simulations. Somebody asked me, one reporter asked me, well, there a purpose to a simulation? You're trying to figure out if there's climate change or, you know, if certain things happen, where will it end up? But I would say, what's the purpose of playing video games, right? We do it for many reasons. We do it for entertainment. We do it to experience things. Like I can't be an elf and shoot arrows at orcs in real life, right? Quote unquote real life, right? But I might want to play that avatar, that character, and have those experiences. And it actually ends up tying a lot to what the religious traditions have been telling us. And about a third of the book shows how the scientific that the simulation hypothesis can provide a scientific and technological basis for what many of the religions have been telling us. But coming back to Jacques Vallée and his ideas around deception, you know, one of the things when I met with him a few years ago about UFOs that many scientists find confusing is that there is a subjective and an objective component. And he says that, you know, he has cases where there were multiple people there. One of them saw the UFO and one of them didn't, right? And so, you know, that's part of what makes it so deceptive and difficult to really unravel what's going on, I think, from at least from the scientific point of view. But I think it ties back to this idea that there is no subjective reality. I mean, if you and I are both in the same room, I can render a bird onto your laptop, but not onto mine. In fact, in video game development, we do that all the time. We call it narrowcasting.
You meant there's no objective reality. You said subjective.
Oh, sorry. Yeah. There's no objective reality. That's what I meant. That there's no shared, that each of us is seeing a rendered version of information, and that information constitutes what's really happening in what we think of as the physical world or physical reality. So I thought that was an interesting aspect of, you know, this deception, is that whoever's playing, running the game or outside the game, might try putting different things into the game and seeing how we react to those things. And I think that that's part of what Jacques is saying in his book, and I think The Invisible College as well.
Free Dreamlanders, we're going to take another brief break here. It's going to be extremely brief, but during this break, strange rays are going to come out of your earphones or your speakers, and they're going to cause you to do exactly what the part of the Matrix that is in these commercials wants you to do.
War Day is one of Whitley Strieber's most powerful books. Join him and his co-author Jim Konietka as they travel across the United States devastated by limited nuclear war. This acclaimed novel was originally published in the 1980s, but now that North Korea has said that they can hit the U.S. with nukes, it's more timely than ever. Don't miss this informative, exciting, and convincing testament to the power of the human spirit in challenging times like our own. Get the ebook for $3.99. Go to Strieber.com for this and all of Whitley's great books.
We're talking to Riz Virk. His new book, The Simulation Hypothesis, absolute dynamite, because for many reasons. One is it isn't so technical that you can't understand it, and it just jumps right out at you. His website is zenentrepreneur.com, zenentrepreneur.com. And you can find all kinds of fascinating stuff on the site and get involved with him. You can join his newsletter. It's free. And he's one of the cutting edge minds in the modern world. I mean, frankly, Riz, you're a hugely influential man.
Yeah. Well, thanks. Yeah,
yeah. I'm not expecting you to respond, but it's just true, folks. You read his CV, and you know he's a very, very impressive CV. Now, I wonder if you're like that in all worlds. And let's talk now about parallel universes, because you know there's a lot of evidence that we are kind of a wave front rather than a single dot somewhere. And can you tell us, can you first of all explain, give a little bit of the background of parallel universes and whether or not you think they're real?
Sure. So, you know, about a third of the book is dedicated to these different findings in physics, which have been confounding, you know, both physicists and philosophers. There was a quote from, I think it was Heisenberg, or maybe it was Schrodinger, who said that, you know, those who aren't amazed by quantum physics haven't really understood it. And, you know, one of the central findings came from what they call the dual slit experiment. And it was this idea that light passing through these two slits can go through as individual particles. And this doesn't have to be just light. It could be electrons or other particles. So if he goes through – a particle would have to go through one or the other slit, can't go through both. Or if it was going through like a wave, in which case it's going through both of the slits, and then it would show up as an interference pattern on the wall or the plate that they have beyond that. And so this was really confusing, because it showed there was this kind of dual nature of matter itself, that things that we think of as physical may actually be some type of field. And it's a little bit easier to understand if we think of the infamous example of Schrodinger's cat, right, which many people have heard of. But the original idea put forth by the physicist Schrodinger was that there was a cat that was in a box, and there was some radioactive material in the box with him. And the cat, after an hour, has a 50% chance of being dead and a 50% chance of being alive. Now, common sense would tell us, and many physicists make this point, that the way we experience the world, we would think the cat is either dead or alive. We just don't know, because we haven't looked in the box. So when we open the box, it'll reveal to us what has happened. But what quantum physics is saying is that it's not until we observe the cat that one of those possibilities comes into existence. Going back to the double slit experiment, it's not till we observe the particle after it's gone through that it ends up becoming either a particle that went through slit A or slit B, or it ends up being, until then it ends up being a probability wave. And so really quantum physics is telling us that a description of the world is a set of probabilities. You know, another way to think of it is, I'm in a movie, the dark movie theater. There's a probability that I may be in any one of these chairs. And it's not until you shine a flashlight on a specific chair that I end up having gone in and taken a seat there. And so this is called the collapse of the probability wave. And no one knows exactly how it happens. In fact, there's a big debate on that. But as far as anyone can tell, consciousness and observation plays a role in that. And so until then, there are all these probabilities floating out there. Now, another interpretation of this is called the many worlds interpretation that says, well, every one of those choices is true in a parallel universe. That in the movie theater example, that I'm sitting in every one of those chairs, each one being a different universe. And every time a quantum decision is made or an observation is made, we are basically splitting the universe into these multiple universes. So, you know, that's coming at it from the physics point of view. Obviously, you know, multiple worlds and parallel worlds is a very popular topic in science fiction. I don't know if you've ever seen the TV show Fringe.
Yeah.
Or more recently, the counterpart that's been on Stars. But in Fringe, they had a parallel world that, you know, took a different path than ours, but many things were similar, like the people, and many things were different. And so, it's being explored in The Flash and the superhero worlds these days as well. So it's become a very popular idea. But the question is, do these parallel worlds really exist, or are they just probabilities or information? And if a world were to branch out, how would that actually happen? So I'm an engineer, and a lot of the questions that I ask in this book are how would that work?
Yeah, because, you know, you think of just the amount of an infinity of material, for one thing. It's mind-boggling.
That's right. And so it's almost not practical. So, you know, one of the big proponents of the simulation hypothesis is Elon Musk. And, you know, he says that quantum indeterminacy, which is this phenomenon that I talked about earlier about not knowing until you observe something, is an optimization technique. And it actually turns out it's a very similar to what we do in video games. If you were to ask somebody in the 80s, can you create a full 3D world like World of Warcraft on your Commodore 64 or your, you know, Apple II, and the answer is no. We don't know, there isn't enough processing power. But over time, video game developers and computer scientists built optimization techniques and built 3D modeling techniques so that we could model the entire world as information. And then we would render only the bits of the world that you were seeing at any given time. So the golden rule in MMORPGs, massively multiplayer online role-playing games, is only render that which your character can observe. And it's interesting how it ties back to this idea of quantum indeterminacy, which you only render that which is being observed.
Well, you know, I think that that this is intrinsic to reality, and I'll give you an example. I don't know if you're familiar with the philosopher Edmond Gettier, who
But go ahead.
Well, you will be in a second. he came up with something called the Gettier paradox, which I think draws the reality of indeterminacy into everyday life. And I'll give you an example. This is called the cow problem. A farmer has a cow that he's concerned about. So he puts the cow in a separate field so he can glance over and look at the cow from time to time during the day and be sure the cow is still okay. There is in the field, there are two features. One is a tree, and the other is a hollow that is deep enough to where if the cow were to walk into it, the cow would not be visible to the farmer. But he figures that's pretty unlikely. He watches the cow, and over the course of the day, things are fine. He looks once, and the cow is under the tree. And so he thinks, well, the cow's fine. But that is not what he saw. He saw a piece of black and white paper that she's a Holstein, that by chance blew in under the tree. The cow is in the hollow. But he is right that the cow is okay. Wrong that he saw the cow. He is right and wrong, in other words, at the same time, about the same thing, meaning that there is no such thing as a justified true belief. It can't exist.
Well, that's really interesting.
And yeah, isn't it?
Yeah, and it gets back to this idea of what is the objective reality and what is the objective truth, and you know, what does it have to do with what we're observing? I think it ties in very, very well to this idea that if the universe is based on information that can change, and we're only aware of a piece of it, you know, it ties to the simulation hypothesis pretty well, I think.
Yeah, I think it does too. I think it means that Schrodinger's cat is an irresolvable problem. We can never know for certain. You know, what was his name? John von Neumann, the physicist back in the 40s and 50s. He died, I think, in 52. Hypothesized that there was that if another mind were to come into contact with our mind, that if it was a stronger mind, and by that he meant a mind that saw the future more clearly, it would take us over and change our reality to fit its own. And it wouldn't be able to help itself from doing that. And I've just often wondered about whether or not every mind in the universe is in the same simulation.
Or if they're in different simulations, right?
Oh, yeah, exactly. Yeah. Do we generate our own simulation? Where's the Wizard of Oz, Riz?
Well, you know, von Neumann was considered, you know, one of the pioneers of the modern computer, right? And
right, he sure was.
In information science, and you know, and he put forward the theory that it was consciousness that collapsed the probability wave. And I do think this indeterminacy, you know, has proven to be a fundamental part of nature, which points at this idea that we're all in our own virtual reality. And you know, I give an anecdote in the book that I started to take this idea more seriously. I mean, I had been thinking about it for many years, but as virtual reality technology got more advanced over the past few years, I was at a startup in Sausalito that was making a VR table tennis game. And so I was holding the controller. I had the VR goggles, you know, on, and I could see the table and I could see an opponent. And I started to play ping pong. And the reaction times were so precise, and the physics engine was you know, so much like our world, that I actually felt like I was playing a real ping pong game and really hitting the ball, so much so that at the end of the game, I decided to put the paddle down on the table. And of course, there was no table, and so it fell to the floor. And I leaned against the table, and I almost fell myself. And it was a forgetting, right, which is, you know, really led me to remember the line in The Matrix where they say, you know, there is no spoon, right? How can you bend the spoon? Well, it's because it's really just part of the simulation. It's not a physical object. And that, you know, led me to explore this idea more seriously.
Yeah. And Free Dreamlanders, we're going to take another break right here, and we'll be right back.
You've probably heard the music for years. It's the theme song for Dreamland. But you may not know the name of the piece, The O of Pleasure. Or the name of the composer, Ray Lynch. Ray Lynch is a 3-time Billboard Award winner. Ray is also the composer of the platinum album, Deep Breakfast. Pandora calls Ray one of the most influential artists in New Age pop and adult alternative circles. For music that will move your heart and set your spirit soaring, visit www.raylynch.com.
Now, we have a situation here that we live in. Like, for example, I'm in a relationship with my wife still, even though she's dead. And it isn't something that just happened to me. I wrote a book about it. You probably haven't heard of it, called The Afterlife Revolution. Anne was a very, very brilliant woman. And when she returned, she did it. My listeners know this story, so I'm not going to linger on it. She did it so carefully that I couldn't deny that it was happening. Now, what about if the spirit world exists, and I think it does, what relationship does it have to this artificial reality?
Yeah, well, I think that's a really intriguing question, and I've certainly heard of that book of yours, although I haven't read it, but
good.
I will.
Thank you.
I think that this idea of the spirit world and the physical world, is one that goes back to really all the religious traditions, whether it's the Western traditions or the Eastern traditions, but they all talk about a soul that incarnates into a body. And then, of course, in the Eastern traditions, there's this idea of multiple lives, right, coming back in. And I mean, it's so much like this idea of a video game that you barely have to make an analogy, where you play one character for a period of time. And there's some score being kept, for your character, and some set of tasks that you have to do while you're playing it.
Yeah.
And then you can
go, like
life. Exactly. Yeah. And, one of our other mutual friends, Danian Brinkley, he's talked about his near death experience. And, one of the most striking aspects of it was this thing called he calls it the panoramic life review. Which is common to many folks that have had, these near-death experiences. And he said he could see everything that he had ever done, but not just from his perspective. He saw it from the perspective of the people that he had done those things to.
Yeah.
And nobody was judging him but himself. But that was an eye-opening experience. Now, before I wrote the book, I was involved in a startup here in Silicon Valley that was basically taking – what happens inside a 3D virtual world or a 3D game like League of Legends or World of Warcraft, where normally you're in there as your character, say, fighting another guy. And we would record as a 3D virtual reality recording everything that happened in a particular interaction. And in 3D worlds, there's this idea of a virtual camera. So you could then put on the virtual reality glasses, even though the game itself is just played on a laptop. And we could put the virtual camera on the other character that you were fighting. So you could go in and experience what it was like to have fought yourself from the other person's point of view. And so, again, I'm an engineer, so I like to say, well, if we do this panoramic life review, how would that work? Well, someone would need to be recording all of these scenes, and it's so similar to what we're doing in our technology. I grew up in the Islamic traditions, and in the Judeo-Christian line, there's this idea of the Book of Life, where you're judged whether you're going to heaven or hell depending upon your deeds. And in the Islamic traditions, they get much more specific. They say there's these angels that are recording your good deeds and bad deeds, and then you have to look at that scroll of deeds. God will show it to you after you die, but not just see it. You have to look at the implications of your actions, which means you may have to go and look at it from other people's point of view and see what happened down the road. And so, I think even what the religious traditions have been telling us is something very much, like a video game. Being both in the world of science and technology myself, and having spent time, with a lot of mystics and a lot of these other paranormal and unexplained phenomena, this is the first model that I found that seems to be able to tie all of these together. And right, normally a lot of people in these worlds don't talk, right? It's like these separate worlds. And in fact, I'm actually surprised that I'm getting interest from both sides, but I also get some pushback, from the people that are so far in one extreme or the other extreme.
Yeah.
saying that, we can't possibly be just AI characters in Mario Brothers from people on the religious side, but that's not what I'm saying. I'm saying we're conscious entities that are playing characters. That's a very different kind of thing. And on the scientific side, you know, one of the reasons why the simulation hypothesis started to be discussed more seriously was an Oxford professor or philosopher named Nick Bostrom, and he put out the simulation argument. And it's, you know, kind of an interesting argument, but it basically says that if any one civilization anywhere in the galaxy gets to the point where they can create a matrix-like reality, meaning a full simulation of the world, you know, they may want to go back and create lots of these simulations. He calls them ancestor simulations. And so creating a new world is just a matter of spinning up another server, and you can create billions or trillions of beings. Therefore, the number of simulated beings is going to be way more than the number of physical beings that are in the base reality. Therefore, if you are a being, just simple probability says there's more of these than these, you're more likely to be a simulated character. And so that got people talking.
You know, I just want to say, just in, and I want you to then continue after this. One of the strangest things that the visitor, the lady on the cover of Communion, ever said to me was when I asked if we had souls. And she said, not all.
Well, that's interesting. Because, you know, one of the points I make in the book is that video games have PCs, player characters, and NPCs, which are non-player characters, who are basically the AIs. And, you know, we're learning as video game developers to create better and better AIs that can, you know, basically impersonate humans. And, you know, in the simulation hypothesis, there's these different versions where we're all player characters, where we're all NPCs, or I think, you know, the more interesting one is where many of us are player characters and some of us may not be. And so just like an NPC in a video game who might be put there to help the characters, the players, or to hurt the players, or to, you know, accomplish a task in the storyline. You know, going back to where we started our conversation with Philip K. Dick, one of the other things that, that Tessa told me was that, you know, he had some conversations with people he believed were reprogramming the reality, and that they would, you know, go back and they tried to prevent the assassination of JFK in Dallas. But every time they prevented it and they went down another timeline, he ended up getting assassinated somewhere else in Orlando or in some other. So they eventually gave up on that, on changing that timeline. But you could see people that are, you know, as a game designer, we insert characters that are AIs in order to guide users to make certain decisions or to learn certain things. And so I think that's perfectly plausible. Now one of the big debates you know, in the Eastern traditions, I think in the kind of Abrahamic line, it's this idea of an eternal soul. One of the differences in Buddhism versus Hinduism is Hinduism, you have an indestructible soul that comes back, whereas in Buddhism, you have this wheel of life, what they call the wheel of samsara or wandering. And every time you create karma, every time you create it, you have an action that you do in your life that gets added to your list of karma. And the karma is the force that keeps the wheel turning. So you come back in your next life because you have all these unresolved quests or achievements that, you know, you didn't take care of in the last one. And you have unresolved issues with various characters. And so in that model, technically, you know, there's a question of whether you really have a soul or not, but really you're defined as a bag of karma, which are all the things that you've done and the things that you were looking to do. And the whole point of becoming enlightened is to wake up to realize that this world is being created based on this force of all these actions. And where are these things stored? They're stored as information outside the physical world.
And you have to wonder where and who's storing them, and, you know, because it's one thing to be here and be part of the simulation and to sense that this may be true, that Plato's cave might be a real place and we might be in it, chained to our chairs and staring at shadows. There's a video game, gosh, I can't remember its name. One of the characters in the game is known as a landsman. And it's an older game. It's probably disappeared from consciousness. But in any case, it was a simulation, and you played a simulated character, except a landsman was somebody who was actually working for the company and knew all of everything that was happening sort of from an eagle's eye view. And, you know, I have to ask myself the question when I see something like that. Could there be landsmen in this world? In other words, people who are silent, perhaps, but no more, and perhaps are responsible in some way for the motive behind the world.
Yeah, I mean, it's very possible, right? Like the landsmen, as you call them, you know, or representatives of whoever is running the simulation. You know, going back to the movie The Adjustment Bureau, right, getting back to Philip K. Dick, there were these characters that were in the world, and they knew what was going on. And in the movie, they kind of presented them, they might be angels or messengers, you know, from the whoever the company was, they called the chairman that was running things and guiding things. But yeah, it's very possible that there are some beings here in the world that know way more than what we know, but they have their rules of engagement and what they're allowed to tell us and what they're not allowed to tell us. And it's the same with NPCs in video games. Each one is programmed to only reveal certain bits of information to the characters, because you don't want to – otherwise, what kind of a game would it be? Now, interestingly, getting back to The Matrix, if you watch the sequels to The Matrix, right, in The Matrix, Neo, played by Keanu Reeves, wakes up with the help of Morpheus, played by Lawrence Fishburne, who is named after the Greek god of dreams, and realizes that they're these super intelligent machines who created the Matrix to keep the human minds occupied. But in the sequels, you find out that one of the first versions of the Matrix didn't have any conflict. It was just, kind of a blissful life that you're living. And they found that humans did not accept it as reality. Like, there wasn't enough there for them to realize, to get lost.
It's not disappointing enough to be real.
Right, exactly. So they made it more and more real, to where, you know, it started to look a lot like our world. So it was almost like the same thing in movies. I mean, what if, and we talked about this last time in Treasure Hunt, what if Indiana Jones was given a little map at the beginning of the movie that said, okay, here's X, this is where the treasure is, just go get it. Well, it never happens that way. First of all, it would make for a very uninteresting movie, right? And so the obstacles and the finding the clues and following the clues is part of the game, and that's what makes, you know, the Indiana Jones films such interesting and fun films to watch. I would say those that's what makes, you know, games interesting, are the obstacles and the fact that we don't have complete information about what's going on, and we're being, you know, scored based upon whatever the game is about. Some games are about fighting. Some virtual worlds like Second Life are just about living a virtual life. And you might say, well, what's the point of that? Well, what's the point of our life here? You know, you get that same analogy. Yeah.
Now, let's get on to what is the most real part of this conversation, which is about dreams. You have some really fascinating stuff in here about what dreams actually are. Can you talk about dreams?
Yeah. You know, dreams are, I think, in many ways, one of the more fascinating subjects of human experience. And in the book, you know, one of the questions that I pose – so in one part of the book is, how would we build something like the Matrix technologically? You know, I live in Silicon Valley and in Boston at MIT, and we're creating different aspects of it. And I have these stages laid out, the 10 stages of technology to get to what I call the simulation point, which is the point at which we can create a virtual reality that looks so real and feels so real that we forget that we are in a simulation. And, you know, we don't have all of those technologies yet. We're about halfway. We're at like stage 5. But as you get to stage 6 and 7, you have to be able to render things by sending them into the mind or into the brain. Like, if you remember when Neo woke up in the quote-unquote real world, there was a cable into his cortex, right, into his brain that was beaming the signals. And you have to be able to take his responses. Like, remember when he was doing the martial arts dojo simulation, right? And he was learning and responding in real time. So there's actually this information issue, and we don't have the technology to do that yet. Well, it turns out there's one aspect of human experience that already, has all of this, and that is dreams. in dreams, we have simulations. They appear fully real. They are rendered with startling resolution in our mind's eye. Our physical bodies are asleep. We forget that there's a world outside of it. There are characters that are created that are not necessarily real people, NPCs, if you will. And then in some cases, you know, people have reported shared dreams and communicating with spirits in dreams. So there are actual other characters in these dreams who are real people or spirits or conscious entities. And so it turns out, you know, dreaming has all of the technological aspects that we would need to build. And so you wonder if that isn't a part of our existence, this ability to create these simulations in the mind. And I mentioned earlier this idea of Tibetan dream yoga. And it's one of the six yogas of Naropa, who was an Indian master in Kashmir, you know, way about, I don't know, 1,000 years ago or so. And the Tibetans have preserved these six yogas, and they're all about learning about consciousness and how our consciousness acts in a dream versus how our consciousness acts in physical life, and then also how to upload and download that consciousness. So there's actually a secret seventh yoga that I mentioned in the book that's talked about, which is this idea of forceful projection, of taking your consciousness out of the physical body and putting it into another body. Now, that's a lot like you know, what happens in video games. And there are stories. There's a story in Tibet of the pigeon saint who was a yogi who had mastered this art, and his horse tripped and he was about to die. He transferred his consciousness from his physical body to a pigeon, which then flew from Tibet into India. And he found a younger body of someone who had just passed away, but that he was able to transfer his consciousness into, and then started teaching this seventh yoga and other yogas, and he became known as Tipapa, the pigeon saint. And so it was a really fascinating story. I mean, almost a horror story in some ways, if you think of corpses being reanimated, but it gets back to this idea of consciousness. You know, what is consciousness? What are we? Is it the physical body? Is it something else? And if you can transfer it, you know, that's what we would need to do to be able to build something like the Matrix, is we would need to be able to inject our consciousness into a character. And then, you know, given what's goes on with dreams and what's happened with many of these Eastern traditions, it may be that that's what happens at birth, is we download our consciousness to this biological entity, and then at death we upload it back to wherever it was from before that.
Well, you know, there's been a long remote viewing program in this world, but now there's a new program which involves a doubling. In other words, I don't know if you remember the story of Sister Mary of Agreda, who was a Carmelite nun in Spain, who converted Indians in northern New Mexico to Christianity before they could be reached by the Inquisition, which would have, of course, hurt them terribly if they had turned out not to be Christians. In any case, she doubled in that she was apparently in two places at once, and there's a discipline behind the scenes of working on this. I wonder if you how that intersects with what your thinking is about the reality of the Matrix. Could people double themselves?
Right. Well, if you think about it, you know, I remember when I used to play, you know, some of these 3D games, I would have two characters sometimes, right? And I remember one instance where I wanted to see, you know, these two characters at the same time. So I had two laptops, and I would log into one with one character and the other with another character, and the characters could be interacting with each other. And yeah, I remember that story. I think I read about it in Diana Pasulka's book, American Cosmic.
Yeah, that's right. She mentions the story of Maria, the nun. Go ahead.
That's right, of the nun, exactly. And so, I think in the simulation hypothesis, first of all, I think remote viewing, you know, as you mentioned, has been going on for a while, and remote viewing fits very well to this idea that everything is being recorded in this 3D simulation, and all we have to do is put the virtual camera somewhere else. to see what's going on. Now, sounds easier than it is, but it would be a very clear explanation for how remote viewing works. It's very similar to how we can, inside a video game, we can say, I'd like to put this, I'd like to go visit these XYZ coordinates somewhere else in the world. And then our computer right. would start rendering that specific character. Now, with doubles, I mean, if we think about consciousness as being separate from the physical body, right? Now, the question is, what did they see, the Indians? Did they see a physical version of the nun in this case, or did they see a vision of her? I suspect in this case, they saw an actual physical person there, right?
You would think that. They saw she was there physically. She even gave them things, little crosses and things, I believe, that they had physically.
Right. Yeah.
In other words, it was a really, it's not something that the church is particularly comfortable with, by the way. But I do think it happened. And I think that because I've seen it myself in another context, that it can be done. It is possible.
Yeah. And I think that if that's the case, the simulation hypothesis explains, provides a model pretty well, because it's really just a matter of rendering your character in another scene, right? Where these other people are. And so, I've heard stories in the Sufi traditions where you would have a character who would go to sleep and then project themselves to a battlefield and show up on the battlefield to give a message, to the people that are there. And they saw him and got the message, from what looked like a physical person. And you hear about these stories in many of the traditions. And what it means is that, what is physical, we think of as physical, is more than physical. And in nature, a lot of biology. So one of my core contentions in this book, and the reasons that I wrote it, is that everything that we think of as physical at some point ends up not being physical. I mean, physical matter is 90% or 99% empty space. And
more than 99.
Nearly 99 points.
It's just a hair below 100% empty space.
Right. And it seems like every time they look deeper into the atom, and then they look into the subatomic particles, and they look underneath that, they really just can't find any actual physical thing there. Well, even within biology, they came up with this idea of the gene before they discovered a physical thing called the gene. And what is a gene and what is DNA? It's a lot of information stored compactly. And then computation is how the biological machines process that to create limbs and create other things. And we're just getting to the point where we understand how that aspect works. Here we seem to be getting at an even more fundamental. And this is why I use the word rendered world a lot. It's not a term you hear a lot outside of video games, but having been in the video game industry, we used it a lot. But I think it helps explain, all of these phenomena, because in the case of this nun, or in the case of anybody who takes their double, as Castaneda would call it, right? Or Don Juan, who taught Castaneda, and appears somewhere else. It's a matter of basically re-rendering yourself in that other scene, and then you can continue right. on for as long as that rendering is there, and then you can say, let's take that rendering away. It's something that science doesn't understand yet, but I think the simulation hypothesis provides one of the few frameworks that I think could eventually explain it.
But toward the end of the book, you have a fascinating section about UFOs and their observed flight characteristics, and how this might make they might make sense if this is a simulation, like the idea that they could move instantaneously from place to place by simply popping out of the simulation and then popping back into it in another place. So my question is this. If we are seeing in these objects devices that are equipped to enter and leave the simulation, who do they belong to, and who do we belong to?
Well, that's the $64,000 question. is, you know, if these devices can come in and out, and anyone who's played a video game is familiar with this idea that, you know, you can inside a 3D world, you can walk from point A to point B, but that's just too slow. You can follow the physics, and every video game has a physics engine. Or you can just teleport from point A to point B. And the way it's done is you just de-render the pixels where they are, and then you re-render them at these other X, Y, Z coordinates. Because remember, rendering is done on whoever's in that scene. It's done on their computer. And so, you know, getting back to UFOs and how could they be defying the known laws of physics? Well, if the known laws of physics are a physics engine, it's pretty easy for the programmers who wrote that to have exceptions to how that works. Right. And have kind of, Easter eggs or super user access to that, and have a certain subroutine that can be accessed, which would be the technology that these guys are using. And you wonder why this technology hasn't come out yet and why it's kept so secret. And, you know, it could be because it is, in fact, from the game creators, and letting that technology be widely available, you know, could mean that anybody could manipulate the simulation and change the world.
Well, I mean, are they? Who are the game creators? If it's not us, are we players or pawns?
That's a good question. And so there are theories ranging from future humans who created the simulation. This is what Oxford's Bostrom talks about in his simulation argument and what he calls ancestor simulations. There's this idea that they are aliens of a different race. And, you know, all the religious traditions tell us it's God is the creator, and that angels are messengers from God, which means they're outside the simulation. Other types of super intelligent machines in the Matrix. So there's been a lot of speculation about that. And I don't have an answer, but, you know, it's fun to speculate about.
Yeah. I've speculated that it may be that we have different forms, and that at this level where we are so physical and devouring everything, we are in effect the caterpillar that will become the butterfly, who will look back at us in amazement and horror through great big black eyes. Riz, it has been really fascinating to have you, as always. Folks, this is a terrific book. It is a really wonderful journey. And I know that, you know, the internet is sort of sapping our ability to actually sit down and read. Our attention span is being attacked every day by our machines. But really get this and try to read it and try to get into it, because you will find in here an escape hatch. That Matrix does not own you. You're only here for a short stay. Riz Virk, The Simulation Hypothesis. His website, zenentrepreneur.com. Riz, thank you for being with us on Dreamland.
Thanks so much for having me back on.
You've been listening to Dreamland. Be sure to tune in again next week. Dreamland is brought to you by UnknownCountry.com and its family of subscribers. Unknown Country was founded by Ann Streber. Our news editor is Matthew Frizzell. Our coordinator is Amy Safrankova. Whitley Streber is your Dreamland host, and I'm your announcer, Ted Alexander. Thank you for listening.